Hi, I'm Austin Wintry, and this is the fifth and final in my Composer Points of View series. Information on the 10 composers that I spoke with can be found in the first episode, linked below. This one I was saving for last because I think this was the one where I got some of the most insightful and sort of juiciest answers. Simply, I asked these 10 composers, what do you think is the biggest mistake that you've made in your career? That can mean a lot of different things. Their answers ran a wide gamut, and here they are.
Ah, goodness, this one was really hard to kind of sort through, because like, it's one of those things where like you go back and like retrospect of, you know, the big mistakes that you think you made, and like you kind of realize how they all kind of filter in towards what ultimately just became your path that you were on. And so like, you know, maybe there were mistakes in the moment, but they kind of also led you to where you are. So it's one of those things where like I could name a couple of things, like sorry, I just got notes on my monitor here. but I think one thing that set me on a different path that maybe, you know, was a mistake in the moment, but kind of led to something else entirely, was early on in my career when I was feeling discouraged about not really getting gigs as a composer. Like, I feel like, you know, maybe I gave up a little too early in terms of like, trying to figure out how to put it, but like continuing to just kind of do stuff on my own, that was kind of sort of like developing my own personal stuff that I wanted to put out there. There was a period of time for sure where I got really discouraged. I sort of did a 180 on my career, and I was like, okay, I'm just going to get into game testing. I'm going to get into the game industry some way, you know, and eventually got into design and all that stuff. And that was, you know, very formative. You know, it eventually formed my career. But there was that sort of period of two or three years where I feel like I maybe was a little bit too complacent in some places, where like I was, you know, too focused on doing something new that I kind of didn't keep up, like composing and, you know, sort of developing other skills, you know, at the same time. Maybe that's just, you know, kind of like a workaholic way of thinking about it, but like, I don't know, like there was definitely a period of time there where I feel like what I was doing wasn't quite what I wanted to be doing. And so it was a little bit of a mistake for me at the time to just kind of put that all aside and focus on something else. But like I said, like in retrospect, like that eventually kind of came around, but I think it made it take longer, you know, it made it take more like 8 years rather than a couple of years, you know, that sort of thing.
I have two. One of them, I think, is it's kind of funny. I think, well, was not funny in the moment, but I think that everyone's had an experience like this, so I'll share it real quick. I was on this project and we were wrapping it up, we were finishing it, and it was a very, very indie project. And it was just like, there was all this kind of back and forth about like, well, we really need, you know, and I was working with a co-composer. We were just, like a friend of mine, we were doing this together. And it was like, they were just trying to get all the rights to the music. And we were trying to retain all the rights because it's like, well, this isn't paying us very much. But for the filmmaker, he was under the impression, and maybe it was actually true, because I know this happens a lot with indie projects. When they're trying to sell their film, you have to like, you got it. The filmmaker has to own everything. Like the distributor doesn't want to take on all that responsibility of paying or whatever. Even though it's really not that big of a deal. But in any case, so it was kind of back and forth of like, you guys, you really need to sign this, really need to get, you know, sign it. And I was on the phone with him, and I'm just like, okay. And he was just like talking in circles and just like, okay, it's, you know, whatever. And it's like, you don't understand. And so I was writing, I was texting the co-composer, and I was like, this fucking guy, I mean, like, this is ridiculous. He's talking in circles. He goes, will not shut up about this. I don't trust any of this. And I press send. And I had sent that to the director.
Oh, God.
I had actually sent my ranting text of F-bombs and F this guy and to the director.
While on the phone with him?
No, I had just gotten off the phone with him. And I don't even know how this happened. And I was like, so I called him and I was like, yep, I just did that. and he was actually laughing. It was not funny, by the way. It was but anyway, it was a professionalism. And look, we've never worked together again. But you know, in all honesty, like, I think we were fine to not work together again ever.
Just, what do you mean? It sounds like it was going amazingly.
Yeah, I think. Anyway, I feel like it's something that everyone is maybe have not done it to, like, to their directors, but I feel like it's like something that we've all done to the wrong person. Like we've sent the exact text to the wrong person or the email to the wrong person. Okay, so that one's kind of like funny. It's like, eh, whatever. So okay, the one that I actually, because I am thinking about this, it's only in retrospect that I feel like, oh wow, this was like a really big, you know, flub, I think, on my part. So I was hired to do this commercial by a director who I've worked with before. But it was kind of one of those, like, those middlemen people. So it's like, he's the director, but he was hired by a company and he was like, this is the composer I want to use. So I'm doing this. So I write some of this music. And then there's like this song that they attempted with. It's like a track. It's like a, I don't know, some kind of track. And they just, the people who had hired the director just really, really wanted this. Get closer to the temp, get closer to the temp, get closer to the temp. So I'm like, okay, well, I mean, hey, those of us coming from USC actually know how to do this because we had a whole class like taught to us about how to do sound-alikes. And I'm like, well, I can do this. So I get, you know, I do it, and I mean, I bring in, and by the way, it's like none of it's working. They're just like, well, we just really want, I'm just like, well, then license it. But they don't want to do that. So they're okay. So I get closer. I bring in George Deering. I play him this thing. And I said, I can't do it. I mean, I can't do right. Like, you just get the vibe. Obviously, I've written it in a way that's not going to be plagiarized or plagiarizing, but here's the vibe. Anyway, so I send it off and I do it and record everything. And they're like, wow, this is really great. We really love this. And then they start coming back and say, we're a little bit nervous, actually. Like, are we sure this isn't, like, this isn't an actual ripoff, like an actual, like, ripoff of the temp? But I mean, you know, more than a ripoff, kind of. And I'm like, no, this is good. This is, I know what I'm doing, whatever. And then the creeping feeling starts, like, it starts coming in. I'm just like, okay, I'm assuring these people of something that I'm pretty sure about, but, so I bring in a musicologist, like, wow. My own. I bring in a musicologist, and I'm like, can you please do this and let me
bless this? Yeah.
Yeah. And you don't have to find it in my favor. I need to know the truth, you know? And so his professional opinion was that in a court of law, it would be very, like, it would probably sway not in my favor because it could be proved that I had listened to the temp and I'd heard the temp. You know what I'm saying?
Right, because yeah, really, intent.
It comes down to intent. He's like, is it the same piece of music? No. But you've done this and they've done this or they've done it, you know, and he kind of, like, one by one, the rhythm, the thing, and again, the intent of it. And it was just a very easily proven thing that I would have had access to the temp. And so then I had to hang's head in shame and go back to my person and say, hey, listen, remember when I assured your people about this, I actually take it back, you know, and I had to take it back. And it caused him to have to go back to his people that he had been hired for. And then, you know, they had to use a different version. The reason why I think it's a perfect, look, it could have been worse, right? What could have been the actual blunder was to let this go. And God forbid if something would have happened.
Yeah. The consequences of that would have been vastly worse.
Right. Okay. But in retrospect, what's interesting is that this director was a personal friend and we had worked on many projects together and there's no reason to believe that we wouldn't continue to work on more. But in the whole process, it's like I essentially caused him to look bad with his client. And while we text and talk, we have not worked together since. He has not called me for things. And I see him posting, so I know that he's doing other things. But then again, I don't know all the time if, you know, you never know. But in any case, I call that out as a blunder, which could have been a lot worse. But it's one of those things where I think it's important that, like, as composers, we have to know, like, hey, this is the line, and I can't go any closer. And what I did was I went closer in wanting to please and wanting to do the thing and get the job done. And I think that the lesson that I really learned from it is sometimes the job is saying that's as close as I can get without, you know, and saying that before you take it down that way.
Yeah.
So, and like I said, it caught, probably cost me a relationship, a professional relationship. It could have cost a lot more than that, but
yeah.
It still did.
Now, how many am I allowed to do on this? You said it was how many questions?
Yeah.
You know, I was thinking about this, and it's a kind of random answer because it's a professional one, but it's also a life one. I'm too honest. I say this not belittling the UK, because the UK is this wonderful place and now it's this hive and so on. But when I was starting out in Glasgow, there was Craig Armstrong and that was it. He was the only composer. And so I was kind of deep. And he was a wonderful guy and he would give me lots of advice and we'd speak to him and did some work with him and so on. But it's a total inspiration. Like, so I was, man, here's this guy from Glasgow that has the heads of 20th Century Fox coming to our shitty little studio at the back of Savat. It was called Savat. It was a studio in Glasgow where all the bands hung out. So that was our life. Yeah, it's like, so you go and do string arrangements with bands, you get to know, I don't know, Sebastian on Mogwai or just Snow Patrol. Or just all these bands were there. So it was just, it was a hive kind of thing. So I remember kind of thinking, well, if Craig can do it, I can do it. This is cool. You know, doesn't matter where you're from. But in Glasgow, you're all just like, you hang out at the pub or you hang out in the coffee shop and you're all chatting away. And then you come to the States and it's a completely different beast, I realized, because it's like, well, look, everybody's nice to each other and everyone's very nice to you. But it's like, is that niceness like that? Or is that niceness deep down? And I don't know, and I don't care, and that's how business goes. But for me, for better or for worse, my wife would probably say for worse, but it's like, you know, what you see is what you get. So the thing is, I'm quite, got quite a lot of energy, as you have. And I think I sort of, to begin with, I didn't tone it down. And I don't really tone it down anyway, but I remember I just scored Limitless. Limitless had gone to number one, and I was asked to go in and meet about a TV show. Doesn't matter which one it was, but it's bloody massive. And I was basically the front runner for it, according to the music supervisor. And all I had to do was just go in and meet the showrunner. And I went in and met the showrunner. And I said, yeah. He said, have you seen the pilot? And it was, and again, I didn't know what pilot season was or anything like this. I was like, yeah, I've seen the pilot. Yeah. It's all right. And he said, well, what do you mean it's all right? I said, well, I like that bit and that bit, but that bit definitely needs some help with music and so on. I said, you need to bear in mind, I haven't done that much TV. I've done more film. So I said, for me, I wanted to, you know, I would come in and do this. And apparently in that one conversation, everyone else was just going, because, you know, I'm just focusing on the show and I go, oh, so, you know, this is fun, isn't it? Okay, it's great. I'm in one of the huts, you know, having a chat about this. And apparently, you know, it's an office like, never ever say that you haven't done this or you haven't done that. You know, why focus on the fact that you haven't done TV and that you've only done film? I was like, well, because it's the same art, it's the same talent. You're still writing to picture. And yes, all right, it is slightly different as far as if you're getting into episodic stuff, how often you've got to churn it out and so on. But in theory, you know, it's the same kind of practical skills. And they said, and also never say that something's all right. And I said, but this, it is all right, you know? I said, it's not brilliant yet, but it's going to be brilliant because it doesn't have VFX on it. It hasn't got music comes up. They don't want to hear it. All they want to hear is that their show is going to be the greatest thing out. And yeah, so basically I lost that. And however many seasons later, it's still, it's like, anyway.
Wow.
I'm phoning in from Rio here, from my 10-star mansion. So it was a learning curve. It wasn't so much a professional mistake, but I do think, you need to be able to be yourself.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's something I can answer. I think the biggest mistake I've made, I would say, is sort of pre-career, which is during, you know, during my college experience, I went to NYU and I had like a fairly, I didn't really make any lasting connections in college and I didn't do any sort of networking. I didn't find myself as a part of any particular community. I was sort of just kind of doing my own thing in my room the whole time, basically. And on the one hand, you know, it's turned out great for me, and you know, I lucked into my position at Supergiant by having an old friend sort of ask me to participate in that I grew up with, and had that not happened though, I think I would have found it difficult to sort of utilize any connections I might have made professionally, because I didn't have any, because of the way that I felt about that stuff. It just kind of made me feel icky, like the whole networking. It just, I had a sort of an unhelpful aversion to that stuff, I'd say. So that's probably a mistake that I made that luckily didn't really end up affecting my life in a negative way, but it's definitely something that I would recommend someone else not do.
Interesting question, Austin. Yeah, what's the biggest mistake I've made professionally? Gosh, what mistakes haven't I made? I guess I'll never know. You know, in terms of the grand, bigger picture career mistakes, you just don't know, do you? But I think I walked off a job once many, many years ago. I think about 4 or 5 years into my career, I walked off a job, and I walked off a job, and I was pushed into a corner by the director to such a degree that I felt that she didn't have the balls to say, look, we're not a match made in heaven. You know, I think I had something like 7 weeks to score 60 minutes of music, and we're getting 3 weeks, 4 weeks into the project, and I had another 3 weeks, and we hadn't got past the opening sequence. And it got to a point where I felt that I had to be the grown-up, mature person and say, look, this is not working. I need to, why don't you find someone else that you can work with? And it's very, very, in fact, that was a grown-up, mature decision I made. And she said, how dare you turn me down? How dare you leave me like this? And that reinforced in my mind. I thought, actually, I'm making the right decision here.
Yeah, I was going to say, this doesn't sound like a mistake at all. It sounds like an incredibly wise.
But after that experience, I vowed to myself, for no other reason, I just thought, do you know what? I'm never going to walk off a job again, because I thought I'd rather be fired than walk off a job. I will always, in that instance, I think it was the right decision to do. But I then actually found out that Dan Pemberton got the job, and he took the project on, because at that time we were both doing lots of factual documentaries and lots of shows. And I thought, good on Dan, you know, he took it on, and I think he probably did a grand job of it, I think. But it taught me a lot about myself, and it taught me a lot in that I know that I don't give up on projects. It's extremely rare. In fact, since that moment, I have never given up on anything, and I'm proud to say I've never been fired yet. That means that I'm not a real composer, because I haven't been fired yet.
Such is the rule, yes.
I have recently gone through an experience which has made me on the verge of having a nervous breakdown and rethinking what we do and our place in music and so on. And I'm working on this project which won't give up. They won't fire. They refuse to fire me, even though I want to. So I think it could be the biggest mistake I've made professionally when this project comes out, or I might get through, and it might be I got amazingly lucky and I could have dodged a bullet.
I haven't thought about this a lot, so I saw your questions and I was like, those look like good spontaneous questions. So
brave man.
Just give me a minute to dialogue with myself.
Go for it.
I think my biggest mistake is not having enough faith in myself and taking time to have a social life and a family life and know that things are going to work out, that things are objectively working out, that at any given point in my path, I was so obviously on the path toward getting the dream fulfilled that I probably could have stopped to, you know, proverbially smell the roses along the way a little more. Now that I'm where I am, I look back and I think I should have done that.
So that's a, yeah, I mean, it's funny because how old is your daughter? She's like 6 or 7?
Seven.
Yeah. Because you've always, you know, no one ever knows the behind the scenes on someone's family life unless they're super transparent about it. But you've, from the start, you've at least projected being, you know, really dialed in with her and really, like, clearly carving out a lot of time.
And I started that. She was a big wake-up call about 7 years ago. And
yeah,
I really realized, like, I was on a collision course. You know, like,
I get it.
And I look back at my 20s, especially, and I don't regret it. So maybe it's not a mistake, but I gave my 20s to my career. That is all that it was. Was that a mistake? No, but I think I was doing it partly out of fear that if I didn't drive 100% all the time, that I would fail. And looking back on it, it's like, hey, I was heading the right direction. I probably could have taken a little more time, been less competitive, been less stressed, just gotten more sleep, like done whatever I need to do, and I would have still landed where I wanted to be. But you live and learn.
Mistakes made. There are just, you know, so many over the course of the last 20 years. I think probably quite a big one for me is just not having enough confidence to kind of keep going at being a composer. Like I kind of felt that, I don't know, I didn't have it. I was too kind of shy to start off with. And I kind of went back and sort of played for a while. And I always wondered to myself, like, oh, if I'd just kind of gone to LA or something, or you know, like made more of an effort when I was in my 20s and pursued it a bit more aggressively when I was younger, like I'd be that much further ahead now. So maybe that was a mistake. Well, maybe not. Maybe, you know, you have to look at things as informing where you are at this moment in time as well, I guess. But like, and just very technical, obvious mistake that also sprung to mind is sent corrupt files, like double check your files when you're having a session, you know, and you get there and you haven't checked something and it's printed wrong and there's no click and you've got an orchestra sitting there. Those are like very obvious
nightmare moments.
And yeah, I have dreams. I have like a recurring nightmare actually that I'm recording like Abbey Road Studio One with like a huge symphony orchestra and a huge, all this, you know, all the producers coming and the director coming, and I like haven't written anything yet. And it, you know, that's my recurring nightmare. I wake up with a cold sweat, like, oh, I've got a session and I haven't written anything. Yeah.
None.
Perfect.
No, the reason I say none, I was thinking about it. I think that, it's a difficult one because I think we all sit back and say, shouldn't have done that job. That wasn't it. But there's reasons why you do jobs. And it's not, sometimes it's to make a relationship with somebody. It's not, the job might not be successful. It might not get great critical success. But I don't think, and I've had that several times, and I don't regret doing it because it you know, it was this, oh, that led to that, and also keep learning from it. I just think it's just I can't now that question personally. I've got a long list of things I can answer, but career-wise, everything is, there's been a reason why it's happened. And I think that, you know, I've watched things where I was meant to do it, and I've kind of gone, poof, I'm glad I didn't do that. But really, that's just trying to kind of rub the broken heart, you know, because you would have got something out of it.
You know, all throughout college, I was very
blessed to go to a great college, and there was a film department there. And, you know, I was here, you know, I already wanted to do video game music for my entire life, but obviously I was studying film music as well. And I took maybe one class, which was like a film music class, actually. It was sort of like a historical film music class, which was great. But all throughout college, I just was very intimidated by this. You know, we had student directors, obviously, and I'm sure they needed music for their films. And there were other like friends of mine in the music department who also wanted to do film scoring, and they kind of snatched up all of those gigs or whatever the student filmed. Mm-hmm. And I always just felt a little too intimidated by film to really get involved. And I didn't. I kind of kept in my insular video game music thing. I was doing projects, but it was, you know, things online, like indie projects and whatnot. And I do somewhat regret not having had the confidence to just say, you know what, yeah, I don't necessarily have film experience. I don't necessarily, you know the technical whatever. And remember, this is like 2001 to 2005. So you couldn't just go to YouTube and find out everything you possibly need to know. Yeah, right. There were like three books on film music at the time, and, you know, not even one on game scoring until like after I graduated. So knowledge was very difficult to come by. And it just
not to
like
mention that those three books would have been like written decades earlier, and so they were all about, you know, locking to mag tape and stuff like that.
Yeah, it was, yeah, exactly, you know. And I mean, you know, God bless Jeff Rona. His was one of the books that I ended up buying, and I loved it, and very inspiring. But, you know, that was it. And so, you know, I kind of shied away from that community. I do sort of wish that I had taken a little bit more initiative. Not because I wanted to do film rather than games. I still was pretty hard set on games, just as I am now. But it's great practice. You know, I think that scoring linear gives you a great perspective on what you're doing with the game. Obviously they're very, very different, but I think in general that sort of set a tone for you know, how long it took me to really be more assertive about my own music and my career development. And I don't want to mess with the space-time continuum too much. Like, I don't think I necessarily would want to go back and be like, hey, do something different now. Because who knows where I would be if, you know, if I did, and then, you know, I don't know, maybe I would have gotten burnt out or you know, whatever. But still, it's like there is a wealth of experiences that I think I kind of missed from not having those interactions earlier. But, you know, again, I'm very happy with how things turned out, and I've gotten very lucky as of, you know, especially as of late. So I don't know how much I want to call that a mistake or a regret, especially considering how much I was doing. My goodness, like, I never slept in college the whole time. It was kind of insane. So adding more to that and being like, okay, now also score these films would have been, I don't know where I would have had the time. But at the same time, it would have been a cool experience. And so many of them have ended up being like big, big names in Hollywood now, and executive producers on huge blockbuster films that everyone knows about. So, you know, we're still friends, but we haven't really worked together. So it's not, you know, like the kind of friendship where it's like, hey, I want this Wilbur J guy to do my next film or anything like that. But still, you know, an interesting sort of retrospective.
It's a great answer. Great. Interesting. Would not have been able to predict that.
There are things that you could kind of cast as mistakes, but I actually you know, everything kind of puts you on the journey to where you are. So I'm always like, it's all part of the rich tapestry of who you are, you know? So I think one of the most like interesting things I did early on was I did this TV documentary for the BBC about space. It was my first kind of big scale documentary. And I had a big vision for it of like how I wanted to be really groundbreaking and not sound like anything else, which of course, you know, producers were like, this is exactly what we want. We want it to sound like nothing else. We want this to be a landmark, you know. And it was a very difficult production, let's say, to the extent even one of the directors got so fed up with it, one day he went home and threw his TV out the window. And his kids woke up and they were like, "Dad, where's the TV?" So,
well adjusted.
That might give you a bit of a backstory of the climate of the production. Anyway, I was having that thing of going backwards and forwards between trying to do stuff that felt like quite different, quite new, and then a sort of type of executive producer, which is sometimes quite common in Britain, being a like, "Oh, we know what's best," sort of top-down attitudes towards making things. And you know, sometimes they do, sometimes they don't. But all their notes completely contradicted everything they said at the beginning. And so I was just stuck in this like horrible tug of war of like trying to work out what to do. You know, they wanted stuff to be a lot more sort of generic, just sound like every other sort of national history doc. I was trying to push to take it a different way. And it was pretty horrible. And then eventually they were like, "You know, we're gonna do you a favor. We're gonna let you go," i.e. you're fired. And I decided at that point to write a 4,000 word letter to them, telling them they were a bunch of C-U-N, two more letters, and they had no vision for television, no vision for doing anything different. They've gone back on everything they've said. And it was like, it was an impressive letter, which I still have somewhere. And it was basically, in retrospect, kind of a career suicide kind of move, kind of like, you know, you have no passion for television, you have no passion for trying to make things different. And, you know, I actually stand by most of what I wrote in that letter, was kind of like, but the difference is now, I would not send that letter. And that letter had kind of like, kind of sort of profound impacts in that I basically kind of got blacklisted from the BBC as a result. I had my phone number changed on the BBC database to that of a plumber, found out years later. I had directors getting called up by people at the BBC telling them not to work with me, that I was difficult. And it pushed me on a very different course. And it pushed me towards directors who I was already working with who were more experimental. You know, if that show was a success, and I was a success, I would have gone down this route of like pleasing, you know, powers that be directors, execs. And that is my job in some ways. My job is, you know, job as a composer is trying to please the people around me. But the thing that was interesting is it shut loads of doors, but the doors it shut were the right doors to shut for me. And it meant I went on a lot more of an experimental path and sort of working with people who were more open to being kind of different, rather than only working with people who wanted me to copy what other people do. And as a result, you know, I feel that actually was hugely beneficial for my development, because had I kind of done everything they wanted, the show was a success, I would have got more work like it, and I'd have probably still be doing that kind of stuff today. You know, the interesting thing is that was a very sort of young me, like in that kind of bravado, like I'm gonna change the world. And then you know, by the time I got to doing films, you can spot these kind of problems and you're like, right, how do I address them now? Rather than like, how do I tell everyone they're a bunch of idiots?
And here we are at the end. Thank you again to those 10 illustrious friends of mine for their generosity of time and for their wonderfully transparent answers to what hopefully weren't too difficult of questions. I am probably gonna at some point share the full unedited conversations with each of the 10, because honestly, I cut the vast majority of what they had to say, lest these videos end up like 30 hours long. So if that's of interest to you, let me know below. Thank you again so much for checking this out. And I may be returning to this format soon with other composers, so keep an eye out. Thanks again.